I think we can start. Good morning and thanks for joining this webinar about how you can publish web services with WebRatio. In this hour, I want to show you how you can create a web service using WebRatio and make you familiar with the concept of web services. This is the summary of the today's session. First of all, we are going to see a brief introduction about what is a web service and why it can be useful to use web services when designing a new solution. Then we are going to learn how you can invoke web services and which are the way in which you can expose web services to other, to external applications. And then we will focus on WebRatio and we will see how you can define a web service in WebRatio. And once you have your own solution built with WebRatio, we are going to see how you can test if the web service you designed is working or not through a set of examples. At the end of this session, I will be here for answering to all the questions you may have. So let's now see basically what is a web service. It's an application component that allows different softwares to communicate one with the other using open protocols. Basically, a web service is an application that is self-contained and usually you have the web service that interacts with a requestor that we can call client using most of the time XML as exchanging the protocol. The web service, which can be called also web service provider, contains two main elements. The first one is the service description. The service description basically is a resource that describes which are the methods you can call of the web service to get information and which is the structure of the messages the client must exchange with the service in order to request information, in order to receive information back from the web service and to interpret this, this response. And of course also the service provider contains also the service implementation that in this specific case will be created using WebRatio. Why web services can be useful? So why I should know about web services and how to model them with WebRatio? Basically, they have different purposes. First of all, they allow you to connect existing softwares all together. You may have different solutions that are not able to communicate one with the other. So you may want to create a web service layer that allows these softwares to exchange information one with the other. Another purpose can be to have a set of reusable application components, which means that basically you may have a set of operations that you use many and many times. So the idea is, why should I make these things over and over again by scratch? I can create a web service exposing this operation so that I can reuse this operation everywhere I need it. Another goal can be to create an application that has the front-end and the back-end attached, which means that the back-end usually contains, for example, the database, and I don't want to let the application access directly this database. What can I do is to put this web service layer in the middle so that my front-end application calls the web services and the web services communicates directly with the database. So as you can see, you have several options and several reasons to at least learn about web services. Now, what you can do is to create a different invocation style, to use a different invocation style for web services itself. We have basically two main methods. The first one is using SOAP. SOAP, I think, is the most known communication protocol for web services. It's based on XML, it's a WTC standard, and the service description in this case is exposed using what is called WSDL file. Then we have another style of invocation that is REST. REST is more recent respect to SOAP and basically allows you to call a web service using a web browser and using a URL like you are calling a standard web application. So let's now see how you can create a web service in WebRatio. First of all, it's important to know that even if you are not so sure about which is the best invocation style you want to use for your web service, you are not forced to choose at the beginning. You can model the web service in WebRatio without taking this into consideration. You can set at the end if you want to expose your web services using REST or SOAP. Of course, in WebRatio, in order to be able to model something, you need to create a web project. So what I'm gonna tell you in this in the future slides in regards what you can do in a web project inside WebRatio. So basically, what you have to know in order to be able to define a web service, you have to know which is the web service container. You have to know which are the main configuration options you can use in order to customize the web service and get the best solution that suits your needs, and which are the main operations that you can use in order to create a valid web service. So let's see now which of these points in details. The service view is the main container you have to create in your web project in order to be able to define a web service. In your web project, the service view basically is a container of a model, and you can add several service view into your web project. It's up to you. And you are free to name the view as you want. Usually what you can do is, for example, to specify a service view for each web service you want to expose. So for example, let's suppose that I want to create a set of web services exposed using the SOAP protocol and another set of web services exposed using the REST protocol. What I can do in order to have a good organization of the project is to create two different service view, one for the SOAP web services and one for the REST web services. Of course, this is how I would organize the project. This is not mandatory. Of course, you can follow your own practices in order to organize the project in the best way you think. So at least you need one service view in order to create a web service. Then the other container which is important is the port container. This can be created inside a service view and it defines an individual endpoint. Usually what you do is to create a port in which you are going to specify all web service methods that refer to the same object. So, for example, in the image reported in this slide, I have a port called User Management. What I would do is to specify in this port all the web services methods that are related to the user. So, for example, the methods for search a user, the method for create a new user, for update a user, and for delete a user. And you can, of course, have several ports in the same service view. It's important to know that the name of the port will be used in the service definition, which is an WSDL file if you are going to use SOAP. So what's important to know is that you should use a name that is XML valid, which means basically avoid using white spaces. And the port is a mandatory element, so you cannot define a web service if you do not create a port inside the service view. Then let's see which are the configuration options. These options are at disposal both on the service view and on the ports. There is an inheritance mechanism, which means that basically all the properties we are going to see can be set on the service view and on the port. And if you override one of these properties on the port, it means that this information will be used for the specific port, overwriting what you set before on the service view. Basically, you have these three options at disposal. The first one is secure, then we have SOAP version and SOAP binding style. Of course, the last two options applies only if you are going to expose the web services using SOAP. You are not forced also to specify these properties at the beginning. If you do not know what you are going to do, you can just keep these properties with the default values, and then at the end, when you are going to deploy the web service, you can come back and change the value of these properties. So let's see each one of them. They are very simple. The first one is the secure option. Basically, it just changed the protocol used to interact with the web service. The standard is HTTP. When you enable the secure properties, the protocol changes to the HTTPS one. Then the SOAP version is a very technical option that allows you to set which is the version of the SOAP protocol you want to use. Currently, we have two version of the protocol, 1.1 or 1.2. And the default option is 1.1. Basically, this property affects the way in which the WSDL definition is created. This is an important thing. When you are going to create a web service in WebRatio, you have to focus on the business logic accomplished by each method. So what you have to think about is which is the set of methods I want to expose with the web service, and which is the business logic accomplished by each web service. You do not have to think about how to write then the service description, because this is done automatically by the tool, which means that once you will deploy the application, you will have for a SOAP set of web services the WSDL definition created for you. So going back to this property, SOAP version means which SOAP version protocol I want to use. And I will obtain two different versions of the definition depending on the value of the property. If you want to know about which are the differences between the SOAP version 1.1 and 1.2, you can refer to the URL I put here. That is an official document, and it well explains which are the main differences. The third option you have at disposal is the SOAP binding style. Also in this case, we have to know some technical information about web services. Also in this case, I suggest you to refer to the following link if you want to know further information about it. But just to give a brief overview, the binding style is how the web service is bound to a messaging protocol. Basically, it means that when you have to call a web service, you have to create a request that follows a specific structure, and you will get a response that follows a specific structure as well. The way in which the request message and the response message must be created. So the structure is different depending on the binding style I choose. So supposing to have the same set of information, for example, I want to pass the first name and the last name of the user, the way in which the request is built is different depending on the binding style I choose. So the World of Web Services gives you four options. WebRatio decides just to support two of them that are the one highlighted in the table. The reason is that these two options are the most used, and I strongly suggest you to use the default one, which is RPC literal. And then to try to change this binding style option only if you are an expert of web services and if you know exactly which are the differences between all the binding styles you have at disposal. So let's see how now how you can create a web service. This is an example of a web service method you can create inside the port of a service view. The skeleton of the web service methods is always the same. You should have an entry point, in this case, this element delete employee. This is an operation. This is called solicit. And this is, as we are going to see in a few minutes, the place in which you have to specify the structure of the request message. Then you must have also an exit point. So what you can see here, this delete employee response, is another operation, is called response, and it gives you back the response message when all the business logic of the web service methods ends up successfully. And of course, you have also to take in consideration the failure case. And this is the aim of this third operation, which is the delete employee error response. This is another operation, as I said. The name is error response. And also in this case, for response and error response, you can decide which is the structure of the message sent back by the web service. In the middle, you can create your own business logic, which means that WebRatio gives you at disposal a set of operations. You can create an operation chain that accomplishes the business logic you want to execute when the web service method is called. So basically, this is not important for our discussion. We have to concentrate on the overall structure that contains elements specific for the web service definition. So now we are going to see in details what you can do with these three operations, the solicit, response, and error response. So the solicit operation, as I said, is the entry point of the web service method. When you create this operation, in the service view, the name you use for the operation will be the name of the web service methods. So as well, as I said, for the port, it's important that this name is an XML valid name. So it means without white spaces. This is also the most important element of the web service structure, because on this operation, you can set some properties that defines the way in which this method will be exposed by the web service. So the first property is the invocation style, and of course you can choose between SOAP, XML, and REST. And as you can see, it's very easy to switch between one and the other invocation style, because it's just an option on the operation itself. So this is why you can change your mind many times. Then we have this stateful property. Basically, this affects what you are going to place inside the web service method itself, so the operation chain. Basically, it means that in some way you are going to authenticate the user, and you will be able also to know if the session of the user is the same of a previous request, and this basically allows you to use volatile objects. Volatile object means basically that instead of just retrieving information from a persistent database, you will be also able to create a web service for managing, for example, the shopping cart using a set of objects that are stored in the user session. Of course, in order to be able to retrieve the correct information in different web service method calls, you must be able to recognize the session if the session of the user is the same of a previous request. I'm not going into details about how to use this property and how this property affects the way in which you can create the web service method. If you are interested in it, I'm here to answer all the questions you may have. Another interesting property is the protected one. Basically, this means that you are creating a web service which is not a public web service that anyone can call, but you want to know who is calling the web service. So basically, you are placing user authentication. From the web ratio point of view, this means that you have also to store information about the user that can access the specific methods, filling the information inside the specific group of tables that take cares about the user authentication, that are user, group, and module. For the client that will call the web service, this means that in addition to the standard information that the web service method needs, there will be also what is called a header on which you have to pass your username and your password. Of course, you will not pass the password as it is, but you will encrypt this password. We have used a specific mechanism to, let's say, encrypt the password and decrypt the password. Also, in this case, I can answer your questions if you are interested in knowing about the protection. Basically, in the modeling, nothing changes. It's just a matter of know how then you have to call the web service to test it. So this is the most important operation of the set you have at disposal to create the skeleton of the web service methods. Then we have the response operation and the error response operation. These two operations do not have any specific properties. What you can do on these two operations and also on the solicit one is to build the structure of the message you want to receive in case of the solicit one, and you want to send in case of the response and the error response. So now what we are going to see is how you can specify this structure for the messages. Basically, creating a structure for the message means that on the specific operation, you are going to add sub-elements to the operation itself. And you will build the web service message using these three elements, parameters, simple fragments, and complex fragments. I know that the name does not let you understand very well which is the difference between them and when I have to use one of them respect to the other. That's why I prepared a set of examples just to let you understand what you can obtain using these three elements you have at disposal. So let's start seeing how you can use parameters to specify the web service message. So the slides we are going to see will have the same structure. What I did is to show you what you can see in WebRatio once you create the message structure. And at the in this blue area, you will see an example of the resulting message in order to let you understand what you obtain when you model the message in a specific way. So, talking about parameters, parameters are the elements that can be added directly on each operation. So, if supposing to be inside WebRatio, if this is my operation, with a right click, I can choose to add a new parameter. A parameter must have a name, and it also has a valid type. The type is basically an XSV type. This is not so different respect to the data type you can use in the domain model, but just to make some example, you can have, for example, a string parameter, a date parameter, an integer parameter, and so on. The name of the parameter must be also XML valid, and you can use only parameters without having to use the other two elements you have at disposal when you want to obtain a plain structure. A plain structure is something like you can see in this box. Basically, you have the main element that corresponds to your response operation, and then you have the list of the parameters. So as you can see, the operation result parameters becomes this operation result node in the next in the XML message. But this can be too simple and force you to have a plain structure. You may have the need to create a structure which is more complex. For example, you may want to have a two-level structure. So in order to create something that is more complex, you can add to a parameter a simple fragment or a complex fragment. So let's see now how you can work with simple fragments. Basically, a simple fragment is an element that can be added to a parameter, and also this fragment has a name and a type. It's called fragment because the real parameter is the group of the fragments. So in this example, this is the solicit, so the entry point for a method that allows you to search for employees. What I want to have is a parameter that is the search criteria used to search for the employees. And then inside, I want to have the list of all the criteria. So as you can see, the first name, this is a simple fragment, becomes an XML node, but that is placed inside the first level of my response, that is search criteria. Search criteria, of course, corresponds to the parameter search criteria. And in this case, what I obtained is a two-level structure. But then, if I want to have a more complex structure, for example, more than two levels, or if I want to use, why not, an XSD file that contains the structure specification of the message, what you can do is to use a complex fragment. A complex fragment basically is a fragment that can be connected to an XSD schema file, and the XSD schema file contains the real structure of the message. So this example shows you which is a possible response for the search employees method. The idea is that I want to have a response in which I have all the results wrapped by one element that is employee list. And inside this employees list, I want to have the list of these employees. Of course, the employees is a complex object because it has first name, last name, birth date, and so on. And in this case, this employee parameter fragment is connected to an XSD. This is an example of the declaration of a complex type. So in this case, the employee fragments is composed by a sequence of these elements that are the attributes of my employee. And I can have one or more occurrences of this group that represents for me the employees. So the message that you can obtain using the complex fragments attached to an XSD schema is something like this. So you have the employees list parameter, then you have employee, which is the name of the complex fragment, and then inside you have the set of nodes reflecting what you specified inside the XSD schema. I know that this can be difficult at the beginning to understand. The best way to learn is just to practice. Since using WebRatio is very easy to model and test what you have designed, it also allows you to save a lot of time. So let's suppose now that we were able to create our web service in WebRatio. We are going to see a live example in a few minutes. Now the question is, okay, now that I have all the web service modeled, how can I deploy it? Well, this is very easy because for WebRatio is like a standard web application. So what you need to do is to generate the web project and you will obtain a web application. Now the question is, how can I understand if the web service is running or not? Well, you have two different ways depending on the invocation style you choose for your web service. If you choose to publish SOAP web service, then WebRatio created for you the WSDL definition file. So if you open a browser and type in this URL that has a standard structure that is the name of the project and this WSDL.do action, what you are able to see is the WSDL definition. And this is the URL you should provide also to all the clients that want to access your web service. If you are able to see the web service definition, it means that the web service is up and running. It doesn't mean that it's working well, of course. We have then to make some tests, but at least the application is ready to be used. And what about REST web services? Well, REST web services do not have a real official way to specify the service description. So what we decided to do is to create something that is more like a documentation that proposes a sample URL and a sample answer, a sample response, in order to let you understand if the web service is up and running, but also how you can test this web service. This will be available starting from the next release. We are going to see this option today because I will use a nightly version of WebRatio. And what we decided is to let you choose if you want to use this summary page or not, because since it's a documentation, maybe once you are really going to deploy in the web service, you may want to disable this option. That's why you have a property that is enable REST summary page on the web project that lets you decide if you want this page or not. And after that, of course, we have to make some tests. Well, this is a very big topic. In my experience, I've used SOAP UI in order to test SOAP web service. I think this is very easy to use, just to understand if a web service is working well or not, if you want to see on a specific set of data you send on a request, which is the response you get. This is very easy. Of course, this product has a set of properties and configuration options that is very huge. So I can just say to you to look to the documentation. But basically, what you should do in this tool is to create a project providing the WSDL URL. And then you can test each method using a sample request. This is what we are going to do in a few moments when we are going to see our example. About how testing REST web services, well, in this case, you can just use a standard web browser because once you know which is the sample URL, you can just type this URL in the web browser, adding all the parameters you need for the specific method and see which is the response. Now let's see in practice what we just see. And what I prepared is a set of methods, but at the beginning I want to concentrate on a specific one that is this manage employee method. Basically, this method allows you to create an update or update an employee. And I want to show you both the SOAP and REST implementation, just to show you that the differences are minimal. So let's go live on Webration. Just to give you a brief introduction, if you're not familiar with the tool, you see an interface that is similar to Eclipse because Webratio is based on Eclipse. You need to create a web project in order to be able to work with a web application. And on the Webratio Explorer, you can see the set of your projects. I have already created this publishing web services project. And this tab you see in the main area is the project already opened in the tool. Basically, a project can be composed of several views. And in this specific example, I created two service views. One is the SOAP web services, and the other one is the REST web services. I didn't create a side view because basically, I don't want to show to the user any page. I'm just creating a set of web services that will be exposed. A side view basically is the container of all pages of a standard web application. So since this is just a set of web services, there's no need to have this view. And if you look at this SOAP web services view, as you can see, I created also a port which is named employees. And inside this port, you can see there are different methods: search employees, delete employee, and manage employee. As you can see, it's very easy to understand how many methods you have created in your service view because you have just to count how many solicit operation you have. So let's concentrate now on the manage employee method. Of course, I used the skeleton proposed, so I created a solicit operation for the entry point, this response operation for the success result, and this error response for managing failures. And as you can see here, I have an operation chains that, depending on the fact that the employee I'm managing exists or not, I'm going to create or modify the employee. Then I'm going to retrieve the newest information about this employee in order to provide them to the client that requested the information. How can I decide if an employee is existing or not? Well, the best way is to ask the client to provide the primary key of the employee if I want to modify it. And this means that on the solicit operation, there should be an information that says that I have to provide the employee ID if I need to update an existing employee. So let's see which is the structure of the message on the solicit. And if we want to see this structure, we have to move on the outline in which there is the manage employee already highlighted because it's the current element. And as you can see here, I have created a new parameter called employee. And I decided to associate this parameter to an XSD schema. And so I specified here an XSD provider. Okay, what is an XSD provider? Basically, if I want to use XSD files inside a web project, I need to declare in the web project that I want to use these XSD resources. So I have to add here a new XSD provider. That means to right-click on the service provider node and choose add XSD provider. Then each XSD file is an XSD resource. So on the provider, I can add several resources, and the resources will be connected to a file, like in this case, employees XSD, which basically is this one. And the only constraint is that the file should be inside the folder of your web project. Coming back to our solicit operation, this means that in order to create or update an employee, I will have to pass this information, so employee ID, first name, last name, email, birthday, and photo, and sex. And the employee ID is not mandatory since I wrote here that the minimum course can be zero. So basically, if I want to create an employee, I can avoid to pass this element. Otherwise, I should provide this element. How can I know the primary key about the employee? Well, you can create a set, another web service that searches the employees and gives you back all the information included the primary key. And the structure of the response basically is the same, since I want to see which are the recent information of the employee. So how can we see this work? So first of all, I have to generate the project, clicking on one of the commands I have here. The best one to test quickly is generate and run. And I already did it, so just to save time, I'm not doing the whole procedure. Then what you need to do is to open a browser, since we said that we have to test if the service is up and running, and type in the URL that allows you to reach the web service definition. So if I'm able to see this WSDL, which basically is also an XML file, it means that the web service is running. If I want to test the web service, it means that I have to open up SOAP UI and create a project. I already did it. Basically, what you need to remember is that you have to provide the URL about the WSDL definition, and then you can create a set of sample requests, and you have a sample request for each method. Then if you want, you can add your own. I created these three for the Manage Employee web service. And this is the structure of the request. I already filled in each node with an information. If you want to test the web service, you need just to click on this button, Submit Request, and you will get here the answer. So as you can see in the request, there isn't the employee ID because I want to create a new employee, but this request, this information is inside the response. And let's see what happens if I'm trying to update an employee that does not exist, or if I'm trying to provide a value which is not valid. So, for example, I want to update an employee, but I'm providing here a string value which is not correct. Trying to submit the request, as you can see here, you have a SOAP fault message that also contains the exception that basically means that something is wrong with the request. So, for example, in this case, it says that it's not able to create a number starting from this string. In this way, you are able to test all your SOAP web services. Now, let's see the very same method modeled and exposed with REST. Okay. So just to complete this example, notice that this manage employee operation has the invocation style properties set to SOAP XML. Then, if we move to the REST web services, which basically what I did is to copy and paste the web service we already see and to change this invocation style from SOAP to REST. With this only change, I'm able to deploy and test the web service using REST. As I told you before, if I want to see the summary page, what I need to do is to set on the project in the services section the REST summary page option. This means that now I'm able to reach the URL restsummary.do and I'm able to see this page that basically contains the list of web services exposed in REST. In this case, I have just one of them, so Manage Employee. You have a sample URL. You have the description of all the input parameters of your request and a sample response. Notice that here you have also some text that explains how you can use the web service. And also for each input parameter, you have a set of the set of parameters with the type and also the nodes. This information are provided by you when designing the web service because on each element you can provide a comment. So what you wrote here on the solicit operation and on all the parameters creating your request and response messages will be used in this summary page. So if you want to create a real documentation of your REST web service, you just have to comment the project you are creating. What we can do to test the web service is basically to take this URL and test it on a browser. For example, what I can do is to provide a name and a last name and avoid to specify all the rest. and see which is the answer that, as you can see, is a valid XML. So basically, this is all that I want to show you about the web services. Of course, I can share with you the presentation and, if you ask me, also the sample project that is up and running. And now I here just to answer all the questions you may have. I'm sorry that I used all the time I have at disposal, but never mind, I can go on after 4 just to answer all your questions. So just type the question that you have. I will read the question and then answer it right now. Then if you think about what you see today later, then feel free just to contact support@webratio.com and we will answer all the questions you may have. Okay, so the first question here is, what are the different reasons for using SOAP or REST? Well, I'm not a real expert about this. REST is easier to use by the client since you just have to create a valid URL, while SOAP has a very standard definition and forces you to use XML structured request. So this is the main difference, and the main reason I think is that REST is easiest to be used. What I can tell you is that in my experience, all the projects that we worked inside our company used SOAP. So I didn't see many examples of using REST. So, well, what I can do is to just ask to some colleagues if they know something about this, and maybe I can answer you by email in order to be more precise. Can we combine XML and JSON for defining web services? Well, using SOAP, you can only use XML. And if you decide to use REST, of course, REST also allows you to use JSON. Right now, WebRatio doesn't allow you to do this. So right now, if you are exposing REST web services, you will use just XML. I think that in future implementation, we can also add this feature. Any other question? Well, if there's, okay, here we have a new question. What are the advantages of programming web service in WebRatio versus hand coding? Well, basically, using WebRatio, you are modeling a web service. So you're not struggling with problems regarding coding by hand, which means, for example, that if you have a problem with the business logic of the web service you created, it's easier to understand where's the problem and to solve it because let's just have a look here. What you need to do is, for example, if you have a problem in this operation chain, what you need to do is to remove the operation or to check the properties of this element and then to rebuild the project and then you can test the new version. So you can save a lot of time, first of all, because you have a set of predefined elements that save you writing the code of each operation. Also, it gives you automatically the WSDL definition, which if you are coding by hand, you will write by yourself and it takes a lot of time and it's error prone, so you can make many mistakes. And an additional feature that I think is very useful and I suggest you to discover looking on our website and on our knowledge base is the visual debug. Basically, this is a feature that allows you to debug the model such as it is a class with a line of code. So you can add breakpoints and then you can make your test and the workflow stops at the breakpoint so you can see, for example, the information provided to this element and which is the information, the operation result. So it allows you also to debug at a higher level of abstraction than on focusing on the code. So I think this can be also very interesting for you. But this all the advantages that you have defining web services using WebRatio, you have also using WebRatio for standard web applications. So if you look on our website, I think that you can discover in the product section which are the reasons why you should use WebRatio instead of other solutions. The recording of the webinar are accessible on our website. There is a section related to the webinar and this webinar has been recorded, so you will find there this session and also the presentation. Can you show how these web services shows in the domain model and in IFML view? Well, talking about web services, we are out from the focus of IFML. IFML focuses on the user interaction. So even if is it platform independent, it doesn't take into consideration business logic. So as well as the business logic of a user interaction is not shown inside the IFML notation, and for this you can use, for example, activity diagrams or some other languages like UML, we decided to separate this in the specific service view. So this is not related to IFML. So if there's no other question, I just want to thank you for joining this webinar. This is my email, so feel free to contact me if you want to have further information. You can also write to support@webratio.com. Our support team will be glad to help you if you want to try using WebRatio. And thank you again and have a nice day.